masters almost surely have a plan. There's clearly maybe something there beyond the realm of man. Until we've thoroughly tested every last close-chested view, I find the more you think you know, the less you really do.
That's true, Dr. Zayas.
Where would we be without TDC? Cause we know they're lying to us just on order debris. Hey, where would we be without TDC? The higher side chat show.
Back in the saddle and ready to ride from sunny San Diego, I'm Greg Carlwood, and I think it's fair to say that many of us have cultivated enough discernment to recognize the coordination between media, academia, the political class, and the capstone cabal in the present, knowing that nearly every new narrative we're presented with is a carefully crafted psyop designed to elicit some predetermined reaction and inch us towards some prearranged objective, because clearly we are not far from rats in the maze. Victims to the push and pull of various ingrained incentives along the spectrum from pleasure to pain. But like a never-ending onion, the further you dig, the more you find new layers of just how deep this manipulation goes, how long they've been working on cracking the codes to human consciousness, and how many of the things you think you know about yourself, your reality, and your history are actually just more pieces to this control puzzle that you have yet to consider. Like the iceberg analogy, the true scope of it all is hidden from even the most discerning eyes. We're served up a curated history propped up by the diploma mafia's reinforcement, mysterious events glossed over and erased, energy, medicine, and true science suppressed for the oligarch's profits, radical transformations of reality's past made trivial by the magic wand of official record and academia's experts. Our own most fundamental tendencies dissected and our mental gears greased with the oils of conformity, consumption, and complacency. Our entire organism mapped and used against us by the sorcerers of this human energy farm. Well, that is how I feel after reading the work of today's guest, an anonymous writer going only by Schwab, who has one of the most impressive Substack blogs I have stumbled upon yet. Always reminding readers we should assess our threshold for coincidence and truly question everything. He writes on a wide range of topics from astral beings and crypto-terrestrials to the manipulation of the human timeline, the true purpose of the world's fairs, and ultimately the transmutation of a divine reality into a dead husk, destroying myth and co-opting the human story itself. I hope you're half as psyched as I am. Let's do the damn thing. The dedicated deep diver, mystery revealer, and true opposition to the jester archons of the infinite hoax, Schwab, welcome to the higher side.
Wow, thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. I have not been this excited for an interview in a long time. Your Substack is far and away the best one I'm aware of. And getting a chance to present some of this stuff to the people is a real treat. But a lot of the content you get into is so unique. I wanted to start by getting a clearer picture of how you view reality, our place in it, and the relationship between human consciousness and physical life, because you pepper in a lot of curious comments throughout your posts, and it might be best to just lay a base in that regard.
Okay, I have a way of looking at things where I think my influences would be Jack Vallée and Marshall McLuhan, mostly, right? And I'm looking at things as we have different layers of existence. And for example, there's a sphere of symbol and sign that we exist inside of in our minds. It's kind of like a virtual environment.
Sure.
I'll put it that way. And we also exist in the biosphere, the geosphere, and then on top of that is this sort of concretion, the technosphere that we're building. And we used to be able to sort of flow in between these states and have a much more fluid consciousness. But over time, I guess the veil, people say the veil is hardening or it's getting thicker. And that, I also believe that we're getting sort of smaller. We're like, we're de-evolving physically and psychically, sort of in a fallen state. Mm. And that's causing, you know, it's one thing to get weaker and smaller and less hardy, but it's another thing that when you psychically de-evolve, or, you know, I use the word goblinize, it's this process of goblinization. And, you know, some people are farther along on this process than others. When that happens to you psychically, you lose your ability to remember things, to see things that are around you. And that's where a lot of the confusion comes, as far as, you know, what are these different entities that we experience? What are ultra-terrestrials? What are the Magonians, for example? Like, we'll talk about that in a second.
Yes, yes.
And my basic, I guess my thesis is that as we sort of shrink, our consciousness shrinks, we become more afraid of death. And in order to cope with that, we dive into necromancy, demonology, technology. All of these things are sort of coping mechanisms. You know, we dive into these sort of very radical departures from the past. Essentially, everything we believe today, everything of the past 150 years, 200 years, modernity is kind of a humanistic delusion. And that, you know, through different things that we can do, through trance, through, you know, eating the right way, getting sunlight, you can slow that process down, or you can break through it, and you can kind of get a glimpse, or sort of remember, you know, remember what the world actually is, what's really there. You can see the sort of, like I was saying, the various layers of reality. For example, like a lot of the entities, you know, like UFOs and things, from my point of view, and I get a lot of this from Jacques Vallée, that what we're dealing with is a very ancient phenomenon. And I think it's a sort of electrical phenomenon, or part of what I call the electromagnetic ecology. And there are, you know, these sort of electrodynamic entities that exist, and they're sort of self-perpetuating, self-regulating plasma, or, you know, like, just think of them as electrical entities. And we used to be able to sort of understand, like, what they were. You know, you could sense them, you knew what their place was. But now when we encounter them, they're just sort of terrifying. And we interpret them through the lens of this other sphere. And we're not able to directly interact with the electrosphere. We're seeing it through this layer, the technosphere, which is dominated with ideas of UFOs, spaceships, and things. And so there's this sort of overlay. It sort of muddies the water of our perception. And I think that there's always a way to sort of drill down and disregard this sort of past 200 years of coping and humanistic delusions, to sort of get through these things and drill down and see, like, what actually happened, where we went wrong, what the reality is. I think you can find your way back, but the key is to sort of start from that sort of intuitive place where you remember that, you know, none of this is real. Like, these things, the sort of radical departure from our real history, the good timeline of this past 200 years, the sort of material delusion, you know, is just sort of a dream. You sort of remember, oh, none of this is really real. To sort of re-enchant your perception and start from there, and then, You just look into the past and you can find your way. And that's kind of what I do as far as my research is concerned. And I usually start from that place of like, okay, I know I can sense this isn't real. I know it's not. Let me drill down. And I always find, you know, some really interesting things.
You definitely do. And that is a great summary. It seems like orientation and point of view and perspective is a big part of the language you use. It's kind of the way we look at things. And that, of course, has been manipulated and directed in certain ways, which obviously we'll get into. And your work also seems to have elements of Charles Fort. I would say you throw in a little Velikovsky and, dare I say, David Icke at times. But you use the term divine reality a couple times, which I think is kind of to say how things would be in the unmanipulated world in the past, perhaps. And you talk a little bit about when you say knowing what this past was like, and we can get there through diet and getting sunlight and structured water, all these things that are just kind of having a resurgence and people figuring out that the system doesn't serve us. We actually need to get outside of those boxes and cultivate our own strength mentally, physically, our own health and all that kind of stuff. That's just really interesting that you can get to kind of human optimization and then get glimpses or echoes of this past unadulterated reality. And just to get into the Magonia stuff and add another layer to the mapping out of what reality is, this Beyond Magonia post, one of my favorites, and you use the term crypto-terrestrials here and there, and I hope the audience is aware of Jacques Vallée's book Passport to Magonia. It's a classic, but to quote this piece, you write, "In the cosmologies of many indigenous tribes, we find a system of worlds arranged vertically or architecturally. There are worlds above and below. The earth is a floor for us, but a roof for those beneath. Magonia is one such world, an aerial fairy realm whose inhabitants are known to have an intermediate resonance, hailing from a realm of lesser density, bodies composed of air. Their high dimensionality doesn't always translate. The technology of their ships seems to produce meteorological effects, including lightning and hail, leading them to be maligned as tempestari or storm wizards, since the frequency of their continuum is constantly subject to fluctuation. Their craft often appear to merge or dissolve into clouds. The Magonians are an example of sky people, a European version of a nearly universal folklore. However, in Europe, that knowledge was actively suppressed by church officials. With a probability bordering on certainty, the geometrical figures known as crop circles are navigational markers for Magonian sky sailors. Their complex geometrical patterns form a kind of hyper-dimensional anchor point, which can be seen regardless of Magonian's volatile resonance. Various trance states, psilocybin, LSD, or reading this article, can facilitate mutual communication with these beings, but also harbors in them the danger of being carried off to Magonia, which should be an extremely unpleasant, mostly lethal experience, since humans usually are not suited to exist in a world with erratic vibrational frequencies." I mean, that is so well written, but I don't know how literally I should be taking what you're saying. Can you elaborate on these sky beings a bit more? I've had a lot of guests use that term plasma. I like that we're going in this direction, that they seem to be plasma or electrically based, but how do these sky beings and their world fit into your wider construction of reality?
Right. So I would have to say that I use a metaphor here. So there are people that are known as targeted individuals, right?
Sure.
And what happens is their perception shifts and they're seeing two different worlds simultaneously, right? Sometimes they're being tracked by, you know, government agencies. That does happen. But I think a lot of the times what happens, and this is also people that, you know, people say they have schizophrenia. I don't believe in that. I think that's a made up thing. What usually happens is you're actually seeing something real, but then it will behave in a way that's impossible. For example, maybe you'll see a helicopter in the sky, right? And then there is an actual helicopter there, but then your experience of it, it's unnatural. The helicopter moves too quickly. It gets too close to you. Nobody else can see how close it is. It has all of these strange behaviors. It has an aura. Maybe the light changes. And maybe there's, you know, of course, different psychic effects where you can feel something and there's like an after effect. And it's very close and very similar in a lot of ways to a UFO experience. There's a lot of the same markers there. The same data points occur. So that's basically what's happening with regard to people seeing skyships. You're able to sort of shift your perception slightly, and that's why it appears like ghostly and everything. But all of these things are sort of happening all the time. It's just you're seeing a sort of deeper aspect of it because, you know, for you in that moment, the veil is thinner.
Mm-hmm.
You're not as the hardening of the senses and the psychic numbing that's caused by, you know, the man-made foods and man-made activities. You haven't fully biomechanically converged with the mineralization of the senses. So you're able to perceive it in this other aspect of it. So yeah, a lot of people would just see a strange cloud, fast-moving cloud. They wouldn't see the definition of the skyship. And that's why you can see this sort of steady decline of these phenomena over hundreds of years. You could look at chronologies from 1,000 years ago, and there would be skyship sightings like every decade, you know, somewhere in Europe or in the world. And yeah, as time progresses or as we sort of, you know, de-evolve and lose touch with that kind of perception, that kind of fluidity, it becomes harder and harder to perceive these things.
Mm-hmm. Like we're in just a human man-made bubble and we can't see outside of it. But basically you're saying like in old texts, and we have this perception that in the past they would say, you know, thunder is angels bowling. And we're like, well, now with our lab coats and our modern experts, we know that it's just because the cold pressure is mixing with the warm front,
right,
and all this kind of stuff. But you're saying there might be an underlying truth to the fact that the things that happen in our sky are effects from activities from something else up there that we don't see.
Yeah. I mean, ultimately, you're dealing with, I mean, what every single civilization in the world called the heavens. It's the realm of the gods, of different deities, of angels and demons. And there is a sort of, there's a hierarchy there. There's a structure, a scaffolding that you're dealing with. So in a sort of very straightforward sense, what you're dealing with is a, when you look up into the sky, you're looking at a visionary medium. As far as you as an individual, like that's really what's happening. It's a sort of a reflection of your mental state.
Hmm.
So if you're in the 100% material state, all you're going to see is a black sky, you know, some points of light. You don't really see the full planetary light show that's going on all the time, or most of the time. It's not like it's people in the past were always seeing these things, but you know, it was just more, I would just say it was more diverse, the things that they saw, the things that came down and that they interacted with.
Sure. And you are walking right into this next kind of thing I had planned, but towards the end of the Beyond Magonia post is one of my favorite things you've written. It's long, but you say, so here we will deploy our own correct mysticism. The sky is the reactive membrane between us and the heavenly realms. In the heavens are angels and devils both. The sky is the screen on which we project our visionary experience It is what the scrying pool, the television, the black mirror, the screen of your phone pretend to be. The sky, the luminaries, and weather events react to our minds and vice versa. Signs and wonders are the heavens in conversation with the physical world. It is the boundary space between us and higher, less physical realms. If you approach mechanically, this boundary space increases elastically. If you approach etherically, it can contract to psychosomatic, luminal, astral, and morphogenic contact up to and beyond the point of physical change. It may impart blessings, curses, or disappearances. You can enter this sacred space through prayer, worship, and cutting all earthly anchors. It is entirely possible in your astral form or in dreams to visit the palaces of the moon. In reality, I love this part, mechanical approaches with rockets would be encountering a void, and in this void, a suspension of natural law. It is a decrease in information, a stretching of the boundary space until it contains nothing. Hence, the decrease in breathable air, the lessening of gravity, and eventually all matter. There is no such thing as a rocket-based approach to, quote, outer space. All the images of planets in science fiction and produced by NASA are esoteric, visionary projections. This idea that heaven's luminaries are in the mechanic void is a confusion of the sacred and profane designed to make you go insane. I just love that. The way you describe mental and mechanical approaches to penetrating the sky, it's just amazing. And there are other posts where you mention casting our will and desires onto the night sky and extracting insight from the reflection.
Yeah.
Man, how would you help people try to get a sense of what you're saying here? And particularly this mechanical approach that we always see. I've had a lot of guests throw shade at NASA for all their CG imagery and stuff, but I still am curious what you think is going on there.
Well, let me start first through the paragraphs of some things people are going to, their eyes are going to roll in their heads. They're not going to hear this stuff. So psychosomatic, luminal, astral, or morphogenetic contact. First of all, like, you can come into sort of direct contact with the sky, and that is what a sort of abduction by the fairies would be, or an abduction by, you know, quote, UFOs. So, and it's going to affect you physically. You're going to feel it. You're going to have sensations. They might be pleasurable. They might be, you know, horrifically painful. It depends. And also morphogenetic, meaning that it could change you. It could mutate you in some way. Or it could possibly, like, you read the old chronologies and it could change. If a pregnant woman were to encounter one of these things, you hear all these old stories as well in folklore of women being abducted and coming back pregnant. It could sort of change your progeny, your children. It could have an effect on your sort of your genetic line. So there's that, right? So it has all of these very powerful effects on people. Like, you can't just, you know, people try to discount the whole thing with people that have had these experiences, but they are changed by them. I think the problem with what happens is that they create a sort of new age religion around it, which isn't really, it really isn't helpful, I think, a lot of the time. Next part is, yeah, of course, also in your dreams, astral form, you can definitely travel into these other realms. Into the heavens. Most of the time, that's probably where, you know, if you have a really good dream, a really high fidelity, like very clear, crisp dream, that's probably where you're going. So I think what's happening with NASA is that there is some part of what they're doing that is a kind of ritual. Like, they are projecting consciousness by getting people to believe in their view of what's up there. They're getting something out of that. I don't know exactly what, but it's almost the same as, you know, it would be the same as if I got a group of people together. You know, we all went out into the desert and invoked some kind of, you know, mystical experience, invoked some kind of visionary experience. And then I guided that. And said, okay, this is what we're going to do. We're going to all focus on the Magonians, you know, we're going to think about skyships and focus on that. And then that sort of would guide our intent, guide our consciousness to that realm. So what I think they're doing, I say it here, the brutish moderns, and we should understand modernity as a form of barbarism, of deliberate, directed, planned barbarism. So their science fiction mystery cult, they're summoning or they're zeroing in on a very specific type of spirit, a very specific type of realm, which I think most people would consider, you know, if you look at the visionary materials that they provide or that science fiction provides, it's always like, especially the older that, you know, the farther back you go, if you look at the Alien franchise or, I mean, a lot of the original older sci-fi, a lot of these things were, I mean, they were just demonic, obviously. And they're very grotesque and they all had a very either parasitic form or a symbiotic, like they want to meld with humankind for some reason. They don't want to just visit. They want to change us. And that's a theme that goes all throughout sci-fi and science fiction. And I don't really separate what NASA does and what, like, what's on Star Trek. I believe it's part of the same visionary mission.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's fair to say there's that entry-level point that people make that Arthur C. Clarke kind of invented the idea of satellites, that
yeah.
There's a lot of stuff in the science fiction that ends up being invented later. And there's also weird situations like the Titanic. There's that book that was written by a guy connected to the military about the Titan before that whole event happened. And it's this unsinkable ship that hits an iceberg and it sinks. So it like rhymes exactly with a real story. And to me, that's some kind of experimentation with playing with reality. I don't know what they're doing, but you do see it a lot in sci-fi that ideas are seeded in the consciousness. If you can get a book, you know, out there to the people and make it popular, then somehow like things end up popping into reality.
Yep. I have done a little bit of research on the history of sci-fi, and that's exactly right. I kind of lost track of it. It's somewhere around. But Arthur C. Clarke is a big one. And then there's basically all of them. They've predicted so much of the world that we live in. You know, of course, you have Brave New World and H.G. Wells with his World Brain book that he had, which was, it was more like political science. But a lot of the things that they write about end up becoming real.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's the school that it's all suppressed technology, or it's like I'm saying here, it's a visionary experience. And that's, if you look at the origin stories of most of the technology that we have, it's like that. It's people having these visions, very informative visions, you know, very clear, high resolution images of schematics, things like that, of like exactly how to build things. So I think it holds true whenever you look at, you know, the origin stories. Like I just looked at Charles Babbage, that he invented like the first computer, and he was a practicing medium, you know,
right?
And he was, you know, basically a mystic.
There's a big overlap there, I think, between occultists and scientists.
Sure.
That
is.
We have yet to really unpack. And where do they get their ideas really?
I don't know, man. Like I haven't really dove all the way into it. That's one of the things I'm going to do. I'm writing a series right now. Reality Ends Here.
Yes.
And I'm on number 2 right now, and I'm going to do number 3. And in number 3, I'm going to go and unpack some of that stuff and bring it more into the psychic realm and the spiritual and occult realm, and show how like all of these guys that created our computers and all of this technology around, they were not normal people. They right. were not just like our vision of them, like tech nerds and things like that. They were not like that at all. They were all visionaries. They were all extremely eccentric, and they used this very magical, poetic language to talk about the things that they were doing. You get this sort of weird impression when you look back and they've got the, you know, the tie and button-down shirt and, you know, the thick-rimmed glasses. But that's completely false. It's a meme.
Mm-hmm. This stuff makes me think about the 1984 analogy. You know, in my world, everyone's always using the Orwellian 1984 analogy for the direction of the world. And it's like, well, was Orwell prophetic or was he read in? Or are we manifesting that because it's such a potent idea out in the general culture now? It's like a really tricky thing to unpack, like chicken or egg kind of stuff.
Yeah, it is for sure. I would lean more towards it being, it creating human weather, right? That's what it's more likely to be. Because it's what we see happening today. And I'm just sort of extrapolating from what I have firsthand experience. I see how they put things out there and they A/B test things. And, you know, they do all these little things, these sort of mass rituals and or whatever you want to call them, simulations to like sort of prime the pump and get the mass consciousness ready. I do think there is also probably quite a bit of suppressed technology. I'm sure that goes on. That's just common sense from my point of view.
Yeah, some of my favorite posts of yours are about suppressed technology and the Magic Mirror 1 and 2 series. But man, there's just so much to your work. I wanted to jump over to a real isolated post about the Great Chicago Fire. It's one of my favorite subjects, looking into historical events, oftentimes disasters, and analyzing a lot of the details that don't add up with the cultural memory of what might have happened, and also sometimes speak to high technology that shouldn't be there. Charles Fort covered some great cases of this, and it does make you feel like we are the property of something far more advanced and hidden from the main stage. But to kick off this post, you write, "Was the Great Chicago Fire the result of a deliberate attack from crypto-terrestrial or breakaway civilization airships? Was it the wrath of God delivered onto a city that was filled with debauched fiends? What's certain is that the truth of the Great Chicago Fire has been suppressed by our vile elites, perhaps because it was their own horrendous crime. Did they simply have foreknowledge of these catastrophes, or could they summon them somehow? These are the questions I will answer. First, we must establish that the given narrative is unreliable or incomplete. The most obvious clue we have is the total lack of a fire signature on many of the buildings and rubble. History tells us of a firestorm that erupted in Chicago, but we see little signs among the ruins. We even see white paper signs untouched by flames." Man, this is right up my alley. It makes me very curious. You also note that nearly every single North American city had a major or great fire over a 150-year period, all of them with strange anomalies. You say no one has done a deep dive on all the fires. There is yet only surface-level speculation fielded towards the meta-conspiracy. Well, help me make some sense of this and recontextualize it in accordance to the details that are often omitted or glossed over.
Yeah, I looked into this. I think this is something that I think a lot of people that are into Tartaria, that's where I first probably saw it. And I wanted to figure out what actually happened. And there's a few different events where you look at it, you can see that cultural memory just sort of, it just loses touch with it very, very quickly. And one of those things is the Great Chicago Fire, and also the sort of the Peshtigo Fire as well, that's connected to that. So let's see. Yeah, you could look at this as a sort of summoning ritual, like the way that, if you want to look at what I was saying before, like you could do a sort of a summoning ritual, or you might know something is going to happen and sort of direct that energy in different ways. I think it's completely possible that, you know, small localized plasma events happen and they're just completely suppressed or ignored. And part of the reason for that is because we don't have the right model for understanding things. People just think it's a fire, or they think of it as an earthquake or something, but they're not actually, because the paradigm isn't correct, all of the information isn't recorded or even perceived.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these things get written down as a tornado or this or that. But in a big one, like the Chicago fires and the Peshtigo fires, which covered 3 or 4 states, and you have all of this testimony that was taken from that, such as the fire balloons. Let me read about the fire balloons from here. An ominous roaring sound was first heard. The balls of fire, like meteors, fell in different parts of the town, igniting whatever they touched. Shortly after, a horrible tornado enveloped everything in fire, smoke, hot sand, and cinders. So the order that things happen in will sometimes be reversed, right? They'll say there was a tornado, there was a fire tornado that was causing burning material to fly up in the air and then fall to earth. But in actuality, if you look at the source documents, you see that the meteors fell first, the balls of fire, and then tornadoes would erupt out of the collision into the ground, which to me, what I'm looking at is electrical phenomenon. All of this seems like huge electrical storms, you know, basically a plasma event that all of these things are sort of a subset of. Here we have, your readers may wonder what I mean by fire balloons, and I confess that I hardly know myself, right? I only use the term because it's so frequently used by others in conversation with me. There you have right there. There's eyewitness testimony, and he's basically saying the semiosphere that we have, the sphere of signs and symbols that helps us to interpret what's happening around us, is incomplete. It's not rich enough for me to tell you what actually happened, but he does his best, right? All the survivors with whom I conversed said that the whole sky seemed filled with dark, round masses of smoke about the size of a large balloon, which traveled with fearful rapidity. These balloons would fall to the ground, burst, and send forth a most brilliant blaze of fire, which would instantly consume everything in the neighborhood. And these sound like plasma balls, which is something that when you research spontaneous combustion, you will run into that as well.
Yeah.
You'll run into sort of these just balls of plasma, and they're called different things, will-o-wisps, fatus morgana, fatus ignis. And they have all these different properties, and sometimes they behave like with agency or intelligence, or they seem to anyway. So, yeah, I believe that's probably what's happening, but it may also be possible for there to be some kind of technology that causes this to happen, that brings it about and enables them to sort of target to a certain degree. Because, you know, like I say elsewhere, this happens to every single city, and it's all of this old architecture. And this just didn't happen in America. This happened everywhere, right? And those cities that escaped this destruction, this era, this like 100 years of destruction, were later on, communists would go in and have this deliberate policy of destroying all these old buildings for a completely unrelated reason. But yeah, they would be razed to the ground. And it was, I think, for the same reason. It was the same purpose behind it, was this sort of enforced, planned barbarism, you know, that they kind of wanted to traumatize the population and create this sort of, you know, look at the architecture that came into its place, you know, just these sort of cube spheres, you know, brutalistic architecture. It's all very anti-human. If you look at it, if you sped up, if you did a time lapse and you looked at any American city, it would honestly look like we were invaded by aliens. It would just, it's this completely, because you can see how it progresses, how architecture changes, and it slowly, slowly, organically develops over time. And then suddenly, within a span of 100 years, it's just these alien glass and steel structures everywhere that everyone really hates, and they aren't conducive to human life in any way.
Yeah.
And they're not even economic. You know, it's just, they make no sense.
Yeah, everything's gridded roads and skyscrapers. And then you look at the past when they had way less technology and tool use, and it's like, holy shit, everything is like a piece of art. Every building is a piece of art as well. And it's really wild. And there's just so many things you mentioned there that are interesting. I looked into spontaneous human combustion last year too, which was such a synchronicity, because who's talking about that? Who's looking into that? But those cases are really insane.
Yeah.
They are not people falling asleep in a chair or their bed with a cigarette in their mouth. They're really, really wild. And I just love this quote from Charles Fort that you put in that piece where he says, "I think that our data relate not to spontaneous combustion of human bodies, but to things or beings that, with a flaming process, consume men and women." It's like, holy shit, that's just great. But in terms of the Chicago fire and the reporting of it at the time, you also included this article from the Chicago Evening Post, the 16th of November, 1871, right in the newspaper. It says, "While large balls of fire were revolving and bursting in every direction, igniting everything they came in contact with, there can be no doubt that the air charged with electricity helped on the work of destruction and death. Mr. A. Kirby says he saw large bodies or balls of fire in the air, and when they came in contact with anything, they would bound 30 or 40 rods away. Others testify that they saw large clouds of fire burst into fragments, and in some instances, great tongues of fire, like lightning, would issue from these dark clouds and light upon the buildings. Pennies were melted in the pockets of persons who were but little burned. A small bell upon an engine and a new stove, both standing from 20 to 40 feet from any building, were melted." And that's very, very wild. You also note that a lot of key infrastructure, like railroads and the mansions of the elite, were not harmed in this event. So there does seem to be maybe a possibility of directing it or having some foreknowledge, because it didn't seem like random rolls of the dice or a random really bad storm or hurricane or something. There's like an intelligence to it, and it avoided things that it might have been asked to avoid. But maybe this is like some demon made of plasma that just ran amok. But it also reminds me, not to get too thorny here, but if you read Dr. Judy Wood's book about 9/11, she is laser focused on one specific thing. She doesn't care about the politics or who did it. She wants to know how these towers fell. And she analyzes a lot of really specific little things. And the line about pennies melting in pockets of people who were not really harmed, that rhymes so well with what she would say. She's like, look, these little holes were created here while this isn't damaged at all. Like, no one really did that nuanced deep dive. She thinks it was some kind of technology, some technology that is hidden from humanity that did this. And they said planes flew into it. So again, it's like, when we look at this old stuff and it's like, well, where are the modern examples? That could be one of an exotic technology used on us in a way that all we have to go on is the story they tell us. And it seems like the Chicago fire is similar in a way.
Definitely. I honestly don't know. I don't know if it was technology or if it was something more occult or if it was a combination of the two. It could have been a few different techniques that were used, and it might have depended on the... I want to do a research project on all on all of the events, all of the cities, but I'm probably going to need like, you know, some help with that, because that's going to be a big, like a year-long project.
Well, I'm sure if you want to crowdsource it, a lot of people listening would be keen to get involved.
For sure. I really want to get to the bottom of that. But there is here a quote that makes it sound like it was some kind of technology. Here's one thing that might show that it was. "A number of these persons assert that they witnessed a phenomenon which may be classed with the marvelous. They saw a large black object resembling a balloon, which object revolved in the air with great rapidity, advancing above the summits of the trees toward a house which it seemed to single out for destruction. Barely had it touched the latter when the balloon burst with a loud report like that of a bombshell, and at that moment Rivulets of fire streamed out in all directions. Barely had it touched the ladder when the balloon burst forth. Yeah, that to me sounds like some kind of guided weaponry.
Right. And the official story of this event is that a horse knocked over a lantern and burned the whole city. So let's throw that out there just so people are aware that the official story is completely bogus. And this was a very, very weird event. Maybe we were attacked from the higher realms.
That was, yeah. Or honestly, like, you could see why it would be suppressed if it was some kind of entity that was rampaging because we had just newly settled this area. Or, you know, there were a lot of people dying in this area at this time, just living. What if whatever came was just attracted to all the death in Chicago at this time, all of the poor people that were just, you know, there was just human carnage.
Mm.
Who knows? But yeah, I would like to get to the bottom of it. But yeah, that's how you know, though, that there is, it's not just a suppression of an event. There's also this kind of like contempt, because they put that story out there, that ridiculous story of a cow kicking over a candle. And if you just read half this article or a third of it, you see how far that is from reality. It's just it's just so absurd.
Yes. And so I had a few other examples of little isolated incidents that kind of helped to build the bigger picture of this like real continuum of lies and false history and hoaxes. And we're almost an hour in already. So I just, before we close the first hour, I just wanted to maybe get a bird's eye view of the timeline of humanity and ask you a bit more about how the elite use the structures and the relationship between consciousness and reality and our desire for narrative against us. Because we started with, you know, what is the real basis for reality and its relationship with consciousness? Well, it seems like the elite have this mapped out pretty well, and they have weaponized it against us. And you talk about narratives versus like the divine reality. You talk about switching timelines, and you talk about their need for us to participate. And I think that's all really interesting. So like, what is the broad view of how the elite over time have weaponized reality and some of the mechanisms that we're just kind of embedded with and reign supreme over us?
How did they get to the position that they're in?
And stay there.
And stay there. Okay, let's look at these events, right? You have different catastrophes. You have a process of people that are, let's say, because the environment is changing, let's say there's less energy available, that sort of electrical plasma environment that, you know, we probably used to live in, with a lot more phenomenon happening, a lot, it would be hard or impossible to deny that, you know, there was more to the world than what was in front of us. But as time progresses, I guess it just gets easier and easier to sort of control people completely mechanically. Let's think of it like this. You have this sort of accelerating effort to make humans forget where they are and where they come from. You have sort of a mass amnesia. And one of the things that I believe that's causing us to goblinize, as I say, is the diet. And that started with grain, shifting from a meat-based and, you know, sort of wild natural diet to this sort of grain-based and really strange, unnatural, repetitive activities, which sort of kill you psychically, right? Like psychically numb you and castrate you, make it unable for you to sort of pierce the veil. The reason why you put these man-made foods out there is to grow the population. It's for more power. It's to secure yourself physically, because the same process that's happening to us is also happening to them. They're afraid of dying. You see that with the transhumanists now, the people that are in charge of everything now. It's the same motivation. They're doing all of this research, all these human experiments. It's for control, but for control so that they can sort of stave off death or at least immortalize themselves in some way, you know, through their control of the environment. It's their way of coping with things. So I see it like that. I see this process of just diminishing consciousness, diminishing psychic potency, right? Because you wake up in the day and we're all in this sort of kind of just a very passive, very receptive state. And then as you gain energy, as your metabolism powers up, you get some sunlight, you get this ability to sort of enact upon your environment and sort of cut through nonsense. But some people don't wake up fully. They don't completely, you know, gain consciousness throughout the day. They just sort of, they get depressed, they get sad, because at no point did they rev themselves up enough. Did they get their psychometabolism up to a high enough point to where they could just sort of change something in their environment, in their world, and create like this small miracle. And once you do that a couple times, even in a small way, like you change the field of probability and you can get something, you're like, oh, wow, I didn't know I could do that. You know, you amp yourself up enough, you sort of are able to see through that. But when your diet and your habits, your rituals, or you don't even have rituals, your habits are just like watching TV and eating man-made or altered food. You know, it's not natural. It's not the complete thing that you need. You're not doing the things you need to do, like hunting or being outside. It's as simple as that. Looking at the stars and knowing it's not the void, just like mm-hmm. that, you know, feeling the world around you in a sort of feeling that ether that you're in, dropping into it. So, yeah, I think that, I mean, I kind of rambled a little bit there, but that's because I've never really tried to explain this before.
Yeah, it's hard to put into words.
It really is, which is why I do the long form. But let me see if I can be a little bit more concise and sum it up. So yeah, that's the essence of it. Just sort of getting your I think metabolism, like the physical, you know, lifting weights, being active, not just as a means to like look better or, you know, whatever, do something with your body, but to get your psychic level up to a point where you can use that energy to change things around you in a very visceral, direct way. That's what all of these systems are keeping you from doing. The food, the entertainment, the kinds of work that are here. So yeah, you know, just try to overcome those things. And once you do, you can see, oh, okay, they're just afraid of dying. You see what's behind all of these things. An escape into necromancy and into wrapping themselves into technology to try to preserve the flesh and try to stave off all of the things that they're afraid of.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it kind of reminds me of Leonardo da Vinci's Vitruvian Man, the idea of microcosm, macrocosm, and divine proportion, and the phi ratio, and all this sort of stuff that seems to be the divine code that we have completely ignored. And instead of building amazing sacred geometrical cathedrals, we build skyscrapers, and we've just totally lost any aesthetic value to life.
Yeah.
Or we're just fooled by the razzle dazzle of Hollywood, and we think that is true art, and it really isn't. There's a couple of quotes here I have where you do speak of this. You say, "The real system of governance is not democracy or even oligarchy. It is this cybernetic management system, the theater of consciousness." And you also say, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. These are the lines of code that created a false reality, a place that does not exist, a place you were born, a cursed plane of emptiness and abstraction, where all inherent quality, the genius and beauty and sacrifice of your ancestors, is leveled down to a self-germinating void. an empty, floating signifier pointing to itself. Therein lies the aim of all their toiling. This is why everything is based on hoaxes, delusions, frauds, virtual realities. To cultivate artificial life, a being that is disconnected from the organic environment and disconnected from the vital impulse of creation. I mean, boom, there it is.
Yeah, there. I said it a lot better there, which is why I write. But thank you for having me on and practicing talking about this stuff in a sort of more dynamic setting.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so I told you initially I wanted to talk about your MK Ultra work. And in a way, most of what we've talked about is pre-MK Ultra mind control anyway. But your post-MK Ultra ecology definitely puts you in a class of people I can count on one hand that have really explored this deeply. And let's set this up with another quote. You write, MK Ultra is the most famous and least understood subject of the conspiracy genre. The very phrase psychological warfare was itself constructed to conceal. Our view is further muddied by the many code names and project titles, MK Ultra, MK Often, MK Search, MK Naomi, MK Delta, Project Bluebird, and Project Artichoke. Then all is buried under a landfill of degraded signal and noise by the ever-expanding conspiratainment industry. Well, I'm going to do my penance for being maybe a part of that conspiratainment industry a little bit and try to correct the record and say, again, I love the way you write and help us better understand things under the MK Ultra umbrella. What have a lot of conspiracy researchers missed?
Okay, so this is like the conspiratainment industry. It isn't really, you know, your fault or any one person's fault. It's because the flashy, salacious stuff is what gets clicks. It's what gets people's eyes and ears to pay attention. And it's really very difficult to get people to understand the larger infrastructure of MKUltra, the true scope of it. There's two reasons for that. For one, it's like you have to lay a lot out for them, right? Most people aren't going to pay attention to that, and then you lose your audience. Then what's the purpose of what you're doing? The other part of it is it's traumatizing, to be honest. Doing this research is like, there's an energetic cost to it. I don't want to say traumatizing. That's a bit dramatic, but there is an energetic cost to learning that MKUltra is ambient. It's everywhere. It's kind of at the root or the core of the American empire and American identity and the way that we do things. It's in everything. It's in the social sciences. It's in psychology. And then there's this deeper part to it as well, where it's not just MKUltra is ambient. It's this way of thinking, which I mostly describe as the, you know, basically the cybernetics, the cyberneticians, you know, which cybernetics means steerage. It's a way of controlling the world. And it's kind of a mental condition as well, a very alienated way to look at humanity. Basically, just a system of command and control for human society. And that's what's at the root of it, because the people that started MKUltra came to the government with these ideas and these schemes. They were doing this research before anyone asked. They lobbied the security state. They lobbied the government during World War II to get these things, to put these things into play. So, you know, a lot of people want to think of, like, you know, some kind of rogue CIA laboratory and, you know, it's the government or it's this. No, it's just a whole type of person that exists. And I kind of flippantly refer to it as the revolution of the nerds. But one of the great books on this is, it's about the sort of, what is it called?
Are you maybe talking about Undue Risk, Secret State Experiments on Humans?
It's not Undue Risk. It's the, It's about how during the Cold War, MK Ultra basically went out into all of the various humanities, essentially, through various programs. So yeah, it's a pretty interesting start. That's where I sort of started, and then I went from there. I saw that there has been no psychiatry without it being militarized. So from the very beginning of psychiatry, the American Psychiatric Association was completely part of the sort of psychological operations during World War II and with the OSS. So from the very start, you have these institutions that were sort of formed around the militarized use of psychiatry and narcotic hypnosis and all of these other things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have a paragraph here that contains a lot of the details regarding the scope that I got from this piece of yours. But like you said, a lot of people write it off as, oh, it was a rogue subsection, maybe just a little corner office of the CIA. It was no big thing. But here you say, in addressing the 1977 Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, CIA Director Stansfield Turner observed that his testimony does, quote, not tell the story, they tell pieces of it. Senate Committee on Human Resources, 1977 is where that came from. What can be gathered from such pieces is that MKUltra was not some isolated program that only involved rogue elements within the CIA and a few scientists. It existed in the context of human experimentation and psychochemical research that involved every branch of the U.S. Armed Forces and Intelligence Committee, as well as 80 institutions, 44 colleges, 15 research facilities or private companies, 12 hospitals or clinics, and 3 penile institutions. In short, a great part of the military scientific complex had a role to play in the U.S. mind control tragicomedy and involvement that continues unabated until the present day. And that really does sum it up. It was a big thing. It's still a big thing. It is a way of thinking. I like kind of the way you put that, is like, we have been under the duress of a cabal that thinks in these terms of domination and manipulation since this day and even before this day. But this is the little glimpse of maybe peak mental tinkering at that time, which of course now it's like the term MKUltra has been mainstreamed, has been used here several times. But this article is really great because you go on to talk about just how many subjects were needed. So they had to, this is a huge operation, and they constantly needed to experiment on people. So that's a whole network in itself, that whole assembly line of people that they're going to use, whether it's from prisons or psychiatric wards. I mean, they were the guinea pigs for all the weaponization of culture we experience now.
Okay, the book was called Cold War Anthropology.
Nice.
And it's by David Price. And that's when I started to see how big the scope is when I looked at his work. And after that, I really drilled down on psychiatry and where that came from. And then that led me to cybernetics. To give you an idea of another branch of this, there is a guy named Humphrey Osmond who did some of the first tests with LSD and studies on schizophrenia. And he was also, like, this is not really part of the main literature. There's just like one or two places where you can find out he was part of MKUltra because of one document where an MKUltra scientist is using his letterhead. So it's kind of tenuous, but it's enough. Like, he's doing LSD research. He's doing it in a place where a lot of MKUltra stuff was going on. But this guy, Humphrey Osmond, is this link to the Macy conferences, where you see a lot of, it's this CIA-funded Macy Foundation, and you see this is where cybernetics evolved, this sort of intersection of math and engineering that came out of the sort of World War II. Part of it was the OSS, which was like the CIA of World War II, and part of it was Division 19, which was like the Dirty Tricks Division, where they were willing to use any kind of chemical or drug or any kind of dirty trick to get an edge on the Nazis, right? And that kind of attitude went from, it just never ended after World War II. It ended up taking this other form in the cybernetics group. So a lot of these people that attended this thing went on to be very influential people. And one of them was Norbert Wiener, who basically created everything we know about cybernetics as far as, you know, he's sort of the godfather of cybernetics. But he was a big mentor to J.C.R. Licklider, who was the guy that invented or came up with the internet, as far as we know it, with ARPA funding. And Licklider's ideas about the internet, it's all cybernetics. He doesn't have any, you know, the concept that we have of the internet as just like a communication device is not how he thought of it at all. He thought of it as the ultimate cybernetic system, in his own words. That's how he talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
So you have this direct line from MKUltra, you know, the Macy Foundation and the cybernetics group, straight to the people that created the internet, which, you know, Licklider was not, he was a computer scientist, sort of, but he was also a psychologist. He was part of this sort of meta profession called cybernetics. And that's how he envisioned what he was doing. That's what he was working on. Mm-hmm. He was working on command and control. And that's what the internet is. It's a command and control system. And all of the things that he was hyper-focused on, such as, you know, virtual reality and creating these displays, it was all about creating sort of these very ordered simulations for people to merge with. In his words, man-machine symbiosis. So that's where MKUltra, like, that's how far-reaching it is. It reaches into every part of the world, into computer science, psychiatry, sociology. And there's a great way of understanding it. This is a quote from McLuhan. He says, electric information environments, being utterly ethereal, fosters the illusion of the world as a spiritual substance. It is now a reasonable facsimile of the mystical body, a blatant manifestation of the Antichrist. After all, the prince of this world is a very great electric engineer. And that is kind of what we're dealing with. We're dealing with, I guess, a good way to put it would be a synthetic astral plane that is being created in the form of cyberspace and the metaverse.
Damn. Yes. I'm really into this. And I have a quote from your post called "The Game Was Rigged from the Start." And you write, the progenitors of the internet knew about network-assisted spooky action at a distance or parapsychology effects related to networking human minds from the very beginning. Jacques Vallée has stated such by saying, there were many people researching the interface between consciousness and computers, for example, with DARPA funding. We began to observe something very interesting. These people were very frustrated because they wanted to communicate with lots of people very quickly, but they only had a keyboard. So essentially, there was a psychic component that we could observe on top of the typed communication. Well, that's very strange. That really speaks to your synthetic astral plane phraseology. But what do you make of this relationship between consciousness and computers? And is it just human consciousness that they're referring to? Or might there be ghosts in the machine?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, there probably are ghosts in the machine, but there's definitely a sense, like if you read the quotes from these guys that I have detailed in Reality Ends Here, that they're talking about something that is alive, right? Here's a quote from Licklider. In a few years, men will be able to communicate more effectively through a machine than face-to-face. We believe that we are entering into a technological age in which we will be able to interact with the richness of living information, not merely in the passive way that we have become accustomed to, using books and libraries, but as active participants in an ongoing process. bringing something to it through our interaction with it, and not simply receiving something from it by our connection to it. That's key, not simply receiving something from it, but like what he's hinting at is being changed by it. So he's conceiving of information and these kinds of dynamic entities existing in space as being alive, as being like, you know, I guess the word for it would be, and I'm taking this word from, you know, world brain transhumanists, they call them simio creatures. So you have these sort of simio creatures in the void, or in, you know, in the ether of the internet, that are already there, I think, in their formulation, but they're becoming more legible the more of these systems that we build, and the more refined our ways of detecting them, our data analysis becomes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it almost makes you wonder if, like, what if they're demonic entities or something? Maybe they coached and guided these early folks to build a system for them. It gets weird when you think about it that way, but they do say things like Gordy Rose has said, AI is like summoning the demon. It's like, where does this language come from? And it goes all the way back, as you're pointing out, to the foundation of some of this technology.
So you just think of like media as the physical and metaphysical extensions of man. It's man extended into the metaphysical as well as the physical, right? Think about what we're doing right now, how I'm in a different country than you are, and we're able to broadcast over space. You're going to record this and broadcast throughout time. So that right there is the definition of metaphysical. It's a capacity that before the past few years, no human being in history, as far as we know, has been able to enjoy. So there's an aspect of it that it is or can be empowering, but we can also, you know, there's, you know, we should be careful with that power. But as far as it being a medium, if you go back to the telephone, to offer an example, that came into being as a medium for communicating with the dead. So whoever died first, as far as, you know, Alexander Graham Bell or his brother, was supposed to contact the survivor through a medium demonstrably superior to the more traditional channel of spiritualism. So basically, one of the first purposes, just like the internet, one of the first purposes that they put the internet to was, let's see if it's got spooky effects. Let's see if we can use it as this sort of psychic medium. The telephone has the same story behind it. So when I say like necromancy and channeling is at the root of technology, it very literally is.
I am so intrigued by this. And there's another point in one of your pieces where you write about how a few years ago, most people were using the internet 3 hours a day. And even at that time, that was considered to be like psychotic.
Yeah.
You know, you have a problem if you're on the internet that much. And now we're on the internet like 7 or 8 hours a day, which is even more insane. And there's all these studies about how kids are being affected, how social media is rewiring brains. But I guess I would ask, if we're talking about this like psychic component of the internet and the possibility of information being alive, if you get the whole world to go through this radical shift where they're using this technology almost 8 hours a day, almost their whole waking day, by millions and millions and millions of people, I guess I would think if this was significant, you would see more effects from it, because the change is quite epic to go from no interconnectivity basically to everyone connected 8 hours a day. You know, if this is significant, where's the effect? Where is the effect of our consciousness being connected in this way?
We just saw the effect. A lot of the effect is what I would call narcotizing the psychic numbing of, to be able to just see things like we call common sense, we just call it common sense, like it's this common thing, but it isn't really. What it is the presumed ability for people to just everyone to see things as they are and to come to sort of an agreed upon reality.
Mm-hmm. Discernment.
Discernment. Yeah, that's a great word. That is the perfect word for it. Discernment. And we take it for granted, or we used to, but it's obviously not a given. It is something that can be taken away. It can be lost. And that's what we just went through. We saw how, you know, a lot of people over the past 2 years just let themselves become guinea pigs, basically, and let themselves be locked up inside for the flu. And, you know, that's being discovered now that it was really, you know, the peer-reviewed science is coming out now, apparently, saying that, yeah, it wasn't really all that dangerous. And a lot of the deaths that occurred were because of the lockdowns and because of other measures that were taken. And that's what it looks like. It looks like society-wide or global alternate reality games and simulations. You know, like these sort of alternate reality overlays that are just going to be installed where a great part of the populations will just go along with it.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're NPCs in a video game.
Mm.
That's what it looks like. That's what the potential of what is the world brain, which is what we're talking about. We're talking about people being subsumed into the world brain. That's what it will look like, especially... I mean, I'm not exactly sure what it's going to look like in 50 years if this process keeps going on, but in the near future, it's going to look like I was throwing out some ideas, like what's going to be the next alternate reality game, as I call it, the next phantom mega event.
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to be UFO thing, like a Project Bluebeam, or is it going to be climate catastrophe? Or is it going to be something else? And pretty much an overwhelming majority of everyone that responded to that poll that I did, I think I got about a few thousand responders on Twitter. It was climate catastrophe. It was everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's what it's going to look like. It's going to look like the TV or the screen saying, there's a climate catastrophe. You have to leave your house. You have to leave everything behind and go into this refugee center. You know, it'll be fine. We'll give you VR. We'll give you, you know, augmented reality video games. You can stay online all day. It's fine. We'll give you whatever, you know, fake insect burgers or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And everyone will just go along with it, even though there's no apparent climate catastrophe happening. You'll be able to go outside and not see anything, or maybe, you know, maybe it'll be some like some bad rain or something, but nothing you haven't lived through before. But just the same exact thing with the flu.
It's like they've got us LARPing. They got us thinking in terms of games, and then they present us with a game in a way, and our networked brains, our centralized networked world brain, just kind of goes with the game.
Yeah, you're really good at at crystallizing my rambling. Thank you.
I try, man. I mean, this is a stretch for you know, my intellect for sure.
It's really hard to talk about, which is why I write the long form. So I really appreciate your help with that.
Of course, of course. And I wanted to back up a little bit to the world's fairs, because there's so much talk about a great reset today. But more researchers who are unpacking the details of the world's fairs are almost considering that to be a great reset of its day. And there's this post that you have, Theater Kid Occupied Government, and it is great. And it has a lot of elements and layers that we could fill a whole show just talking about that. But you do have a section where you go into the world's fairs and you talk about them in a way I've never really heard other people talk about them. Some say that we know that there's millions of dollars spent on these events from the robber baron class. They constructed them and deconstructed them. And there's some head scratchers there because some people think, well, that stuff was already there. And how could it have been erected out of just plaster? And then there are some examples like San Diego, where Balboa Park is still there. Those structures, magnificent as they are, I guess the locals were like, you're not tearing this down. You just built this and it's amazing. We want to keep it. So they acquiesced and let San Diego keep it. But then it's like, well, if this was built of plaster made to only last a few weeks, why is it still there in 2023? And it seems like a regular building to me. But just to quote you here, you say, fairgoers were issued passports and given notebooks to record their indoctrination experience. The notion that these events were focused on entertainment is nowhere evidenced in the photographs of sullen attendees dwarfed by the oversized grounds purposely built out of human scale. Commentators in 1851 expressed particular surprise at the seriousness of the event. As Humphrey Jenkins noted, the fact is the Great Exhibition is to them more of a school than a show. What was a matter of tedium and became ultimately a mere lounge for gentlefolks is used as a place of instruction by the people. Eventually, however, the mass indoctrination ritual became disguised as entertainment. Well, when you look at this, what did these world fairs do to benefit the elite, and what did they help to cover up regarding what might have been elements of the old world?
So yeah, there's this cutoff point, and another thing I do is I research giants. So around 1850, before 1850, pretty much everybody in America believed that giants were real. Like, they'd dig up giant bones. It was just sort of common knowledge that there was a race of giants that existed in the United States before, or maybe with the Indians, but definitely before Europeans settled there. And then after 1850 to 1870, with the establishment of the Smithsonian and other sort of more centralized, like governmental anthropological organizations, you see this kind of other culture being created, sort of, you know, built on top of the old one. And I think that, yeah, this is what this is. This is one of the first sort of cybernetic, artificial, sort of like astroturfing of culture that happened. You know, before 1850, you had the organic culture. You had a certain type of person who would never have allowed buildings to be raised to the ground, would never have allowed some of the things that have happened in this country because of the things they believed in, right? They were sort of connected in their cultural mythology to the mythic realm, right? And people that are connected to the mythic realm with an organic culture they're harder to control because they're not afraid of dying. They're not afraid.
They believe in something bigger than themselves.
Yeah. And they can be very rowdy. You know, they can, even the first time they tried to mask everybody up, and I think it was in the 1920s, they did another run, kind of like what we dealt with coronavirus. And they tried to enforce these masking rules. You had people like violently attacking the police, or people telling them like a lot. I mean, I know that same thing happened in the past couple of years, but it was to such a degree that they had to sort of shut it down very quickly. It didn't go on for very long because people are just like, no, there's no way. I'm not afraid of you. I don't care what you say. I'm not afraid of the consensus. I know what's real. And that kind of connection to the mythic realm had to be, for any of the things that have happened, any of the programs that have taken place since then, like all that had to go. So that, like I said before, in other places, this is why everything is a lie. This is why everything is a sort of inversion of reality. It's to sort of disconnect you from the real, disconnect you from your sort of organic enchantment or your organic connection to, you know, the eternal realm or to the heavenly realms or these places outside of you, or even just 2 feet outside of you. Nowadays, everyone's sort of reduced down to the level of a worker, which is what the point of these world's fairs was. It was to celebrate industrialism and celebrate the machine. It was basically an induction into becoming a cyborg. You could think of the world's fairs themselves as cyborgs, immense cybernetic cathedrals that people were inducted into, you know, these sort of very these very artificial virtual realms. And I do think some of them were probably, some parts of them were plaster, you know, some parts of them were fake. But I do believe that a lot of the buildings in those areas were real, and they were destroyed 100%. They were dynamited or burnt. And it was part of this, it was part of this ritual, like a mammoth ritual in which all of the power relations are basically rearranged. You know, all of the organic connections are rewired. And part of doing that would be, of course, you know, annihilating those beautiful buildings, which would have been a sort of a temple, a testament written in stone to a form, to an image of mankind. So they, in order to overwrite that image, to reformat that image, they needed to get rid of all these buildings. And not just in America, but in every single country in the world, mm-hmm. all of these old world buildings were with some pretense, you know, whatever it took. Because you can't have this huge reminder everywhere you look, all around you, of this other image of man that they're trying to delete.
Right, right. It reminds me of some of those Orwellian types of books and literature, like Fahrenheit 451,
yeah.
or there's even the movie Equilibrium, where the cabal is always trying to get rid of art, because art inspires and art is our connection to the divine. So if we have this really magnificent architecture everywhere that inspires people to be better, that kind of innately shows people the value of aesthetics, well, you can't have that, because it's always like 1 degree from connecting people to the divine and reminding them of their true nature. So it must go. I think about the analogy of like a switchboard. If our consciousness is tethered to the ethereal, to the true divine, well, then we're always kind of in a relationship with it, subconscious or otherwise. And it's like they unplugged that from the divine and plugged it in over here to a different switchboard that they control, that is really just an illusion, you know, just a really gross synthetic version of that, that they control. And then they control all elements of our thought by extension. It gets pretty wild, but this is a paragraph that speaks to a lot of things that you're hitting on. I just think it's really well written, and I just want to throw it out here. But you say, according to the historical record, these were the largest gatherings of people of all time, constituting the most popular and effective mass medium of the 19th century. The organic mortal theater of America and the West in general was uprooted and replaced with meaningful displays of mass production, fabrication, mass communications, and urbanization. It was at this time that the widespread understanding of cyclopean architecture, 3 centuries of New World anthropology, knowledge of an unknown precursor race of larger than modern humans, and the primacy of scriptural history was completely demolished, to be replaced with Darwinism, the current imperial racial order, and the cult of industrialization. The idea that a race of physically superior humans had created an impressive civilization on par with anything in our world, an idea that matched scriptural history, the entheographic records of nearly every indigenous tribe, copious physical evidence, and the universal acceptance of the physical and moral decline of man since Pliny the Elder, all of it needed to be ejected from the theater and make way for the new synthetic narratives. I mean, that's exactly what we're talking about.
That's it. And the hubris of it, and the, I mean, it's just so arrogant. Every single, pretty much every single tribe that exists in North and Central and South America, they all have stories of giants. They all disavow like a lot of the structures and the earthworks. Like, you know, when they were asked repeatedly or from the very beginning, they were like, oh, we don't know what that is. That has nothing to do with us. And some of them rarely would know that it was from like giant, they'd say giants built it. But a lot of them had stories about giants as far as who was there before they came, And all of that's just disregarded. Like it's, you know, oh, it's just some Indian myth to this day. So, yeah, that's one of those things where you realize like the people, you know, they're not motivated by the sort of science academic goons, as I call them, or, you know, the academic mafia does not care about, you know, history or facts or anything like that. A lot of the motivations of people in the academy, it's just prestige.
Mm-hmm.
That's all they care about. And it has been that way for a very long time, for at least 100 years.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And so I just thought that little segue into the World's Fairs was interesting because it parallels another giant epic undertaking of changing human consciousness in mass, and we're going through something like that now. And to get back to cybernetics and how the internet was created, now we could talk a little bit about gaming. It seems like you're doing some new research into gaming. You told me you were exploring gaming as a divination medium and games as a way of focusing psychic energy. Kind of speaks to like the psyops that they keep throwing at us and how everyone participates and kind of doing their part as if it is like some kind of game. And you did a deep dive into Blizzard, Activision, Call of Duty, Ubisoft, and how they all have ties to military intelligence, and they're not really just entertainment companies. But here you have a couple of quotes I mashed up where you speak about the cutting edge of how this data mining in gaming is being used. You write, "They have harvested player data in order to train machines for applications such as drones, self-driving cars, wargaming scenarios, and more. Data is the new oil, which can be used by corporations to predict, control, and manipulate human behavior through surveillance enclosures, artificial semiospheres, or metaverses. The process of endlessly repeating hyper-specialized tasks within these gaming environments is making it increasingly easy to replace the vast majority of humanity with automated systems. The major video game publishers are parasitizing your data body to grow and feed digital clones of you." Well, when you put it that way, it seems like a much bigger deal than just a time suck into some video game.
Yeah, that's how it's framed, right? But yeah. There's another one that I have, another article, where I talk about all of the patents that are out there that show that this is what they're doing. This is what they've been doing for a while. And where is it? Yeah, digital homunculus.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. And I wanted to figure out, how did that get started? How did we get to the point where every major video game company are using games to create these sort of digital clones of people, to train AI for all kinds of purposes, like psychometric profiling, basically using the psychometric profiles to create risk profiles, which then can be used as financial instruments, all of these different things. Like, how did they get there? And I decided to look into the history of gaming. And yeah, it's a very, very deep rabbit hole. The deeper you go, the more spooky it gets. I guess people might know about Call of Duty, which is basically a psyop. It has been used as a psyop for a long time. But then there's this other part of it where there's experiments that are being run inside of games and have been for a long time. I'm still trying to get to the very bottom of that to see how much of the, like, things that are, what I believe my thesis is that the construction of the games and the so-called problems that games are having now are part of the experiment. I haven't quite proven that yet, but we're going to get there. But in Reality Ends Here too, I kind of get into the origin of the use of data as a weapon, right? And how it can be instrumentalized. And I think I go back all the way to Vietnam, right? So that's where our idea of using data in this way is where it begins, with the Phoenix Project. And once again, the Phoenix Project deserves its own article in its own investigation, because this is something that I thought, oh, it was just a terror and assassination plot.
Mm-hmm.
Like, most people don't even know what it is. But if you're in this realm, that, like, conspiracy stuff, you know that that's what it is. You've heard about, and it's been talked about in that frame, but that's really not what it is at all. It was an exercise in data science. The core of the Phoenix Project was a data center, right? It's crazy. Like, and then there's another one, Igloo White, which is the same kind of milestone of data weaponization that happened during Vietnam, where they were, like, shooting these terrestrial penetrator airdropped acoustic monitors, basically, like, monitoring platforms that they would just shoot like missiles into the ground all along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And they even had experimental drones. The QU-22 drone was patrolling it. And they had all kinds of, you know, sophisticated gizmos in Vietnam. And you can see that Vietnam was a huge test bed for the data economy and for everything that we're dealing with now. But let me go ahead a little bit towards the spooky part, which is kind of more in line with what we're talking about. I kept digging and I kept digging and I kept finding all of these things. And then I finally got to the point where I go to the first text-based adventure game called Zork. And then I look at Zork, and Zork was developed at the MIT Laboratory for Computer Science with DARPA funding, right? So this is like one of the very first games that was commercially successful. I think it was the very first commercially successful computer game, text-based adventure. And it was described as being very addictive, and it had, like, celebrities were addicted to it and would talk about it. Robin Williams, apparently. It had a lot of hype around it, right? You know, it's just a text-based adventure. I remember playing it when I was younger because my dad was into that kind of thing. And it is. It has a very weird vibe to it. And it's very interesting. But if you look at the history of Zork, they say that it was based on another game that also came out of this DARPA-funded constellation of research facilities that all have connections to the CIA and, you know, to human experimentation. But it came out of another place, and there's this story about a divorced father. You read the Wikipedia, making a game for his daughter. You know, he's using the world's most advanced supercomputer, but he has, you know, he has time to make this computer game. But I looked at this sort of progress report from 1974. I found it. And this is before anything was made. And they describe a teleconferencing game. To test the system, a game was devised wherein conferees attempt to find one another in a simulated maze of hallways, each user seeing broadcast messages and a schematic view of the immediate surroundings and other visible players. This is a description of what playing Zork is like, right? You have a kind of like an overlay over, or not Zork, or basically like Zork or one of the MUDs, the multi-user dungeons. Basically, the first computer games, this is what they were like. They were like gamified teleconferences. And of course, Zork was multi-domain, like, you know, it was on the network. So you could potentially have two people playing in the same environment.
Hmm.
So here's where it gets weird. This experiment occurred at roughly the same time and place as Jack Vallée and SRI were experimenting with altered states of communication and the spooky effects of teleconferencing. So the very same time that they're making this gamified teleconference, Jack Vallée is experimenting while he's doing, you know, he's hanging out with people, like all kinds of occult people, and hanging out with people that are, you know, doing LSD, a part of CIA MKUltra research. He's writing a research paper where he's calling the computer conference a structured communication environment that could serve as a way to develop what might be called dynamic modeling. And this is how he describes it. Computer conferencing can potentially provide an environment in which the three components of modeling, process, data, and people, are supported in new ways. It can process documents automatically. It can support an interactive process in which human judgment melds with mathematical operations. So he's conceiving of the teleconference. You just think of it. We have this sort of psychically numbed view of what a teleconference is, but he doesn't have that, especially not at this time. He could see it for what it was. This is human judgment, which is discernment, right? Human discernment melding with mathematical operations and alternative data. Alternative data being, you know, sort of data that's alien to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you could think of mathematical operations as algorithms, like the algorithms that sort of guide your attention around.
Right. It's like they were monitoring human rats in a digital maze.
Monitoring and nudging and pushing them around, mm-hmm. and melding with your discernment, reordering just a computer conference by entering into the highly structured environment of the computer regulated information network. It is reordering your discernment. That's how he saw it. That's how Licklider saw it. That's how all of these guys, Engelbart, that's how they all saw it. They have the same kinds of, you know, very metaphysical understanding of what's going on.
Damn.
And straight after that, he says, the development of this potential suggests the need for new software to include mathematical processes and databases as non-human participants in the computer conference. What he's talking about is like Licklider's dream of the dynamic model, where he considers the human mind to be this dynamic model, like a sort of interactive, a model that moves, like an airplane, you know, that can actually fly. That's a dynamic model.
Mm-hmm.
But he thinks of the human mind as that. So in other words, the concept proposed is to build large models by enabling them to evolve dynamically from a flexible meta model, a virtual environment like a game. So you're going to the game and it's creating a new equilibrium for this dynamic model, this model of reality that you have that exists in your mind.
Right, right.
So that what the computer conference actually is, it sounds like, okay, computer teleconference, it sounds like this boring thing, but it's actually akin to a psychedelic process. Valet calls it an altered state of communication. He says here, the conference in which some participants are non-human, and those non-human participants can be algorithms, databases, so DARPA's sophisticated chatbots, NPCs, and so on. So once you realize that a computer conference is an altered state of consciousness, you could see why his next step was to research and to see if there could be any psychic effects that could be coming out of teleconferencing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I'm skipping ahead real fast. There's one last thing I want to say about Zork. So first, let me tell you about Licklider. He also was very into teleconferencing. The assemblage is, of course, a meeting. It is a conference. You may be observing, indeed, that a significant tele, in the sense of mutual feeling or psychic affinity, is forming here. A teleconference is an interaction of minds and their respective arrays of wisdom, knowledge, values, and skills. Or in less mentalistic terms, a teleconference is an interaction among processors and stores of information. That's how he's visualizing it. And that's probably a lot closer to what that is.
Mm-hmm.
So if you think of Zork in video games and MMORPGs and all of these things, and even things like Twitter and social media, all of these things are kind of basically just teleconferences, some of them text-based, with a graphical overlay.
Mm.
And before, the people that created Zork, their goal of the Laboratory for Computer Science, the LCS, the goal of Project Mac that they were under was automating programming. So that's kind of the whole thesis of like what I was saying about what games are being used for. They're used to train AI on player models to sort of automate the process of programming AI. And so from the very beginning, Zork was created by a group called the Dynamic Modeling Group. So right there you have it. I believe that, you know, right there, that's a pretty strong indication that games are basically from the very beginning devices, virtual environments for people to go into and to be basically modeled and remodeled. So Valet starts doing experiments around 1976. The primary purpose of the experiments was to test remote viewing under the altered state of communication enabled by computer teleconferencing. So this is some pretty crazy stuff. He's working closely with CIA-funded Project Stargate researchers. And you have, you know, Wikipedia or whatever will tell you that this research didn't come up with anything, but I have right here the source documents that say results confirm earlier reports of successful remote viewing experiments while extending them to cases in which participants were thousands of miles away from each other with control of communication provided by a computer network. So he found that computer connection, computer conferencing amplified psychic connection between people.
Damn.
Whereas there wasn't any before, because what he's, think about it like this. When you're in a computer in this highly ordered space, it's a kind of sensory deprivation.
Mm.
And so it focuses the psychic energy into the act of communication much more than when you're talking face to face.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. And you think about, like, so you spent a couple of decades gathering this data on people and nudging them around in different simulated synthetic environments that you created, communicating with different NPCs and being presented with various choices, and those choices are monitored and recorded, and you've got decades of data. And then it almost seems like they just took a point and started gamifying reality. And you could look at COVID as this weird thing where we're all glued to the screen. We see these people dropping on the streets of China.
Yep.
And then we have the NPC newscaster pop up and is like, this is what's going on. This is what you need to do. And maybe all this data they gathered is like coming out in these new psyops, like a LARPing or a gamified reality. We just went through the COVID one. We might go through a climate change one, seems likely. And if they really want to be bold, we might go through a fake alien invasion one.
Yeah.
And they're going to probably use all the data they've collected to sort of using all the screens that we're constantly attached to gamify our actual reality and get us to respond, nudge us around to respond as they have directed us to.
Yep, that's exactly it.
Damn.
That's what's going to happen. That's what is happening.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't think that the point is to run away from the computer or anything. If you understand what I'm saying, and if you can kind of just hold at least a piece of this in your head, you can use these systems. You can, you know, you can sort of speed run through them and hack them and whatever and use them to help people, basically, to get people to not lose themselves in these systems.
Yeah, yeah.
You can definitely do that. That's what my kind of my whole goal is.
Interesting. Yes, and it requires a better context for the lay of the land and how everything's being structured so that you can kind of be an antidote to that.
I found this one document. This is one last thing. This is from Stargate, CIA document, Enhanced Human Performance. The typical Psy experiment with RNG involves three main components: an observer, a truly random number generator based on radioactive decay or electronic noise, and an experimental task linking the observer with a device such as a game, such as a video game. So this is from the very beginning. And then there's a whole slew of video games being out there just in the wild that are used for testing ESP. And I, another idea I had was that wouldn't it be amazing or interesting if some of these games were sorting devices to sort of find people that had psychic abilities? That's another avenue that I want to go into, because I do think there are people that are kind of like super users that for some reason they go viral or some reason people are drawn to them. And I think a lot of people that you see that are able to engage with these systems and get a lot out of them have some of these qualities. They have, you know, a higher ESP rating or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. And clearly they are thinking in terms of simulations, because if you go back, it seems like every time they roll out a big PSYOP, you can find that these very same people funded a giant simulation like Event 201.
Yeah.
Or Operation Dark Winter. It's like very much in the mix. It's baked right into the cake that they run simulations to make sure there's no questions as to how people will behave, what percentage of them will go along with things, what percentage of them will reject it, how do we handle those people, how do we kind of destroy their digital avatars so they can't speak out, we cancel them, we censor them, we blacklist them. Yeah, it's really interesting. It seems like that's the process. There's just one little other thing I wanted to try to fold in here, because who knows if and when we'll talk again. But you have this two-part series about magic mirrors. And we could say this kind of relates because, you know, broadly speaking, it seems like we're controlled by sorcerers who use every thing they have in the magical toolbox against us. There was the pre-digital age where they had to do it, you know, with the old grimoires and the old techniques of consciousness manipulation. Now they've got this digital network that helps them do it even more so. But these posts have a lot of content about these stories where there were mirrors that could show all events or future events. And in modern times, Project Looking Glass has been talked about in the same way. But it's pretty mind-blowing to think that such technology could even exist or existed in previous centuries. And we've done some deep dives on John Dee before, but some of this seems to go beyond just John Dee, right? And again, it goes with that obsession with knowing every possible outcome.
Definitely does seem like that. And I just have this kind of assumption that just as technology is sort of hidden or suppressed, or it's released in this very, like, it's just like rolled out very slowly over time, the same thing would be done in the past. It gives you this sort of asymmetric power over, you know, the huge populations of people that could potentially rise up against you at any point. You know, you're not going to just throw everything out in front of people. I think it was used a little bit differently in the past, and the kinds of technology that they're using now to control us need to be hidden for them to work. Like, they need to be invisible. Like, you need to not know what a video game is, really. You know, a networked game is, and what all of this technology really is. You need to go into it and use it completely unconsciously. So other things that they had, like, you know, I talk about flying devices as well that you see everywhere, that apparently a lot of the, you know, elites or the kings would be able to have these other devices that could be from an, you know, an older age. It could just be something, you know, a suppressed technology or a sort of parallel society. They would use it in sort of like to demonstrate in front of people to cow them. I think it was used in a much more direct way in the past, which is why we have so many records of these things being used in the past, because it was just used in a much more like a flashy way, right? I'm going to fly around and everything. But as far as the magic mirrors go, yeah, 100%. They're going to be used for the same thing. It's I have this quote, like, the ultimate display. This is one of the goals of Sutherland and the guys that came out of ARPA, the people that built all of these wonderful devices for us. He had this quest to create the ultimate display that could show you everything, sort of like a fully immersive environment. And I do think that that's a, you know, in order to control a large, you know, group of people, this is something that you're going to want to have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just real quick, the thing you said about you need to not know you're in a game really to get true organic results, because knowing it's a game alters the results. People might take more risk or whatever. Well, that is a real analogy for what a lot of people have been talking about life itself. There's a lot of conversation about, is this a soul school of some kind? Is reincarnation real? Is there a soul trap where we're being captured and put back into a simulation, some kind of energy farm? And there's a lot of debate about, like, well, what is life and all this kind of stuff? But I think it is a soul school, and you have to not know that reincarnation is real, or you have to not know that you have a life beyond death for this life to have meaning, or for you to have a truly organic experience. You can't know about past lives. You can't know about the soul to a degree. I mean, the thing about it that seems divinely designed is that if you inquire about such things, you can get glimpses of it. You can get clues that it exists, that there is more to it, and that's kind of baked in at just the right degree. But you have to come into it thinking, this is the life I have, and I have to learn it. I have to learn about my morals and ethics and make choices. And I don't know, I think there's just a real good parallel there to life itself and the divine design of it.
Yeah, we need to be immersed for it to work.
Mm-hmm.
For it to kind of really sink in, I guess. We need to be immersed in the game.
Yes, we do. And so finally, you know, before I let you go, we have talked about some pretty incredible things, the depth of the manipulation of man through history and the corralling of us into this dead husk of a reality tunnel by the jester archons of the infinite hoax, as you put it. And we know a new great reset operation is upon us. The dial on PSYOPs is firmly in the red. Well, we kind of talked about this a little bit, but since I'm going to tack this on to both the free and plus versions of the show, I want everyone to hear like some final thoughts in terms of how do we best navigate what seems like it's going to be an intense decade. What might you describe as the actionable intelligence in your work?
Okay, so one of the things that I talk about a lot is, it's a concept that Patrick Ryan, he coined the term psychosecurity, but I have my own version of it. I believe that I kind of have a cheat code of my own. The reason why I'm like good at what I do and finding the research is because I have natural intuition, and I've thought a lot about it and done a lot of introspection, and I'm pretty sure that arises from what people call blood memory. And I think that the way to awaken, or you could call it Akashic memory or whatever you want to call it, the way that you get that is through rituals. And they should be rituals that resonate with you in this world that your ancestors practiced. You shouldn't just make up something, you know? So, you know, for me, that would probably be, you know, certain Catholic rituals, putting meaning into that. And everything you do habitually becomes your ritual, and your consciousness proceeds out of those rituals. It's what you have, like who you are proceeds from those rituals. And I think it changes everything for you as far as how you integrate with these machines, with these systems. Because I don't think there's any way to really like run away and do the Luddite thing, you know, live in the mountains. This is going to be everywhere, right? Ultimately, there's no way to get away. So my point of view, the only way out is through. Mm. And that's just to you know, be completely anchored in the physical reality, in your own psychic reality, in the divine, and have rituals that align you with those spaces, with those spheres of action. So for the physical, it's going to be like lifting weights, going outside, running around, doing something physical, play. You know, for the mental, it's going to be, you know, try to read a book, or just, well, I just sit in the sun and just blank my mind out. I don't even know if it's meditation, but it works. You know, it's just blank out and, you know, sit there. Yeah, whatever it is, it has to be the thing that is the most rooted in you. Not just you as an individual, but you as a part of this like living chain that goes back to the creation of this world. And that's going to be, you know, sort of ancestral rituals. Like, and I don't just say do the Catholic stuff. I also try to, you know, look at some pagan rituals as well. Mm-hmm. And that can be, you know, grilling meat. It can be something really simple. So yeah, psychosecurity, keeping your rituals, making sure that the things you do are meaningful. And then also, like, when you go online, it's really important to not log on in the first 2 hours of the day or before your metabolism is keyed up. There's something called doom scrolling that a lot of people do. It's like there's like heavy doom scrolling and light doom scrolling. Heavy doom scrolling is like where people just completely lose hours of their day and they're on Twitter and they're just going down and they're really depressed. And it turns them into what I call like a void tweeter, where they're just shouting into the void. Or you can do that with YouTube or any social media. You just start doom scrolling through it. And then there's like light doom scrolling, which is what most people do, like veg out and watch YouTube videos. And they use social media in a very passive way. It's not generative. They don't go on and they don't like have a mission. They're like, okay, I want this kind of information or I want this kind of experience in this space. They don't take it seriously. Mm-hmm. They're just letting their time get chewed up by the time eaters. You could think of the simio creatures that we talked about before. You could think of them in that sense of being these attendant entities that are hungry for that which is most precious, like us going online and doom scrolling with this weird vegetative intention of just like giving our time over to them. It could be seen as a sacrifice, you know, very powerful, potent ritual that empowers them, but leaves us like husks.
Right.
That to me is like the real matrix metaphor, the real battery metaphor. That's what you're empowering. You're empowering these, you know, virtual worlds and virtual entities. So that's my method. Psychosecurity, I'm going to give Patrick Ryan credit for coining it, but all of the rest of the ideas about doom scrolling, that's all mine. That's my homebrew version of that, of how to stay sane through the next alternate reality game that's coming down the pipeline.
Yeah, so well said. And it's kind of like you have to put yourself first because we are void of ritual. And in that void is the doom scrolling and all this stuff. So go back to culture, heritage, bloodline, honor the ancestors, go back to prayer, consciously steer yourself towards your goals and fortify your mind and body. And when you do those things, there's not a whole lot of time left in the day for doom scrolling. But if you put the doom scrolling first, you never get to the things that matter. So yeah, I think there's a lot of wisdom in that. But amazing stuff. I'm very grateful that you agreed to do this. We didn't even talk about California as an island or out of place artifacts or the Hindenburg disaster hoax, but I hope we can do it again sometime in the future if the people respond like I think they will. Give them your links or any other follow-up info you might want them to have before we call it in.
Yeah, I'm on Twitter at, I forgot my Twitter handle.
Real Human Schwab, I think.
Real Human Schwab. That's so crazy. Real Human Schwab, that's me. I'm on Twitter. And then my Substack is Schwabstack. So Schwabstack at Schwabstack.
Amazing. Yes, people will really enjoy going down the Schwab Stack rabbit hole if they choose to, but this is just a taste. And you are something special, man. I really appreciate your time and what you do. Keep fighting the good fight and take care.
Thanks a lot, man. Thank you very much. Have a good night.
And a good night he did have. Yes, people. The real human Schwab in the flesh. You know, I like to keep the lineup pretty diverse and cover a large array of topics, but this kind of stuff is my favorite. And I can't believe the material we left on the table. Schwab's Substack is just my favorite, and there's so many posts we could focus interviews on. There's a handful of Substacks I've been following and really enjoying, but Schwab just nails it. I'm into his whole vibe, his subject matter, his writing style, his anonymous nature, and his choice to use the guy from Twin Peaks as an avatar. Just all around, I'm a fan. Two of his best pieces are actually about the Hindenburg disaster, false flag, and the devastating loss of that technology. I mean, really, you gotta take a look at the pictures of what this was like and then ask yourself why one disaster killed off an entire technology forever. Is that true for trains or ships like the Titanic or planes or anything else? I mean, even a handful of them shouldn't be enough to lock something up until the end of time. But the other one would be his post about California being an island on a ton of old maps with an island of giants in the middle before you get to the mainland. And really, that's all next time material. But if you guys liked this, you gotta let the man know. Shower him with praise, and how could he not want to come back? Because I'm assuming that a lot of you guys are primarily in it for wild stuff like this. And let me just read two quick paragraphs that I still have in my notes that I didn't ask him to elaborate on because we ran out of time, but I think you'll like. We are truly in a mirror reality, the city of the Magi. It has revealed itself to be false many times over. Somehow we're led into this labyrinth through a smoking mirror. Into an image that at first mimicked a faithful copy of the sacred living earth. Fascinated by this reflection of the divine cosmic imagination, we fell across the threshold into this strange sublunar realm. In order for us to rewild our minds, restore our senses, and return to the sacramental order, we shall find the mythical edge of this world made of words. So I say, here is the way. The first telling of a tale is the truest. I really like that. And he goes on to say, the modern man has been boiled in the dark waters of materialism. He believes in things like self-creating universes and self-birthing organisms. The god of modernity is a masturbating dragon wrapping itself ever tighter around the rational mind. In the middle of that Ouroboros is your conscious reality. Constrained on all sides by a state of disenchantment, the germ of wonder sterilized, all arranged by powerful men that were fully enchanted, that practiced magic and used it to construct this current global order, preserving for themselves a belief in a vast, divinely constructed cosmos. Since at least the 15th century, a network of hostile economic elites have been working to transform humanity into a programmable golem. Openly celebrating their own efforts, you simply insist on forgetting because you are insane, seduced by the theater of the present. Fucking A, right? But speaking of my notes, the outline auction is still happening. I got about 100 up there, and there's still a good number of them that don't have any bids. So if you're not picky, but you still wanted one, that could be a good thing. Although the ones people want, they really want. Some are getting up there, but 3 days left in the auction at this point, and a new batch coming online just before the first one ends. I didn't want to bring a laptop up to Mount Shasta, but I kind of have to get this done. Hopefully I see some THC fans up there. It's going to be a good weekend, but a long drive for me. I think it's a little over 11 hours, and that's just the state of California for you. But it will be nice to drive through one more time before the long goodbye. But I tell you this because there will be a slight gap in shows. I should have one back from our editor waiting for me when I return, but I'm going to need some time because the day after I get back, I have an interview I've been dying to get for years, actually. And thanks to our buddy Ron Patton, producer of Ground Zero, who used to co-host a few THCs with me back in the old, old, old days. Thanks to him, it looks like it's finally happening. I never celebrate until we're actually pressing record, because just having something on the schedule is never a guarantee. I've learned that long ago. But if it happens, I think people will be quite surprised and excited for it. This is a guy who would have a star on the Conspiracy Walk of Fame. Let's just say that. But once I get that recorded, I will get back to turning good stuff around to you. Also, I gotta thank Chasing Maxwell for his rendition of today's theme song. I liked this one and thought it sort of had an 8-bit or video game kind of sound, and that's appropriate for this show, especially if you heard the second hour. And if you are musically inclined, I would love to hear a take of your own at thehiresidechats@gmail.com. I don't have many left in the chamber, so I'm just going to go back to randomizing them, I guess. I wish I had a ska one. I wish I had a piano one, or really just a couple from every genre eventually, I think would be the goal. I can always just pay for more from people who don't really have the passion, and it shows. Or I can plug your band, or your SoundCloud, or whatever you got. But as far as the plus show goes, man, this whole episode was stuffed, and I basically have enough left for a part two just from the same outline. But in the second hour, we talked about Schwab's deep dive into MKUltra, and that is a Chris Knowles level deconstruction, dare I say. We talked about cybernetics and the psychic component, ARGs and phantom mega events, Schwab's take on the world's fairs and the last reset of sorts, video games as divinatory medium, digital clones, Zork, military intelligence, parapsychology, and gamified teleconferencing, gamified reality in general, the secret history of strange magic mirror technology, and the divine design of life. Just a real blast all around. I thought it was a really good framing of the constant operations that are being thrown at us as being like an ARG or being like a LARP, that we've been kind of conditioned to play games, and so they present stories to us with like action items and we all just get on board. Interesting stuff. But sign up for Plus at thehiresidechats.com and kick it all off with a 7-day free trial. This would certainly be one of the ones to do it for. It's not like he's on 50 other podcasts either, right? But before we call it in, we always got to take a peek at the THC meetup calendar. Just going to plug the February events again. But we got the Higher Soup meetup with Gordon White at Foxglove in Wellington, New Zealand, February 11th, this Saturday. And also this Saturday, an event in Mount Pilier, Vermont. The 15th, we got the Seattle Inquisition coming around again. This is at least 4 or 5 for them, I think. And the Sinspiracy Monthly number 2, February 17th, Blue Ash Recreation Center in the Hunt Room in Blue Ash, Ohio. So not too late to add more to that last week of February. If you got a light calendar, let's get something on the books. Hop over to HiresideMeetups.com, make an event. It's easy. I'll read it and people will show up. And if you hear about one in your area, please use the RSVP system so the host knows that they won't be alone. It's just good manners, and I think good manners we must have. But it's fun. Meet other locals that you know are of a certain caliber and build out your network of people who also know the value of doing so. And that's pretty much it. Shoot Schwab a hi there and hello on Twitter at RealHumanSchwab. He also does occasional spaces there, too, which can be themed or kind of like live Q&As about his work. And if it sounds like you'd enjoy reading his work, sign up for his Substack at schwabstack.substack.com and tell him the Carlwood sent you. Well, I gotta go. I am hitting the road bright and early, but I'll see you next week. I've done my part. Your move, plasma weapon wielders, upper plane entities, and jester archons of the infinite hoax. Your fucking move.
From space it was falling, its light started calling, it's making crop circles again. Just as I was looking up, it showed me all the hidden stuff, and now I'm all enlightened and zen. Waking up the masses is hard. Silver ships are coming yard by yard. Now I'm not asleep, don't obey the elite. Got a beep to the head. Now I start to wonder, now we're not the sheep that they bred us to be. Got a beep to the head. Now we start to wonder, now we start to wonder. Of corruption and crime, since the visitors set me straight. I encourage you to go when you see the saucers glow. One by one, we'll all end up awake. Enlightening the masses is hard. Silver ships are coming yard by yard. Now we're not asleep, don't obey the elite. Got a beam to the head. Start to wonder, no, we're not the sheep that they bred us to be. Got a beam to the head. Now we start to wonder. 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 Just as the system starts to die, cabals hate it when we make it, so they'll break it, and next round they'll erase it. It's a big loop, what can we do? Still, it's time we had another, cause we're not the sheep that they bred us to be. Got a beam to the head, now we start to wonder, now we're not. We got THC and a beam to the head. Now we start to wonder. Now we start to wonder. Now we start to wonder. Now we start to wonder again. We start to wonder. Now we start to wonder. Now we start to wonder again. Now we start to wonder again.
You're going to try, go all the way. Otherwise, don't even start. If you are going to try, go all the way. This could mean losing girlfriends, wives, relatives, jobs, and maybe your mind.